The Arabic word Muslim literally translates to mean someone in submission to the will and law of God. The message of Islam has always been universal in scope and intended for all people. It is he or she who accepts this message that becomes a Muslim. One out of every four persons on earth is a Muslim. The religion claims 1.8 billion followers, which equates to about 24% of the global population. While Islam is currently the world's second largest religion, after Christianity, this faith is also the fastest growing religion. In 2070, Islam is projected to surpass Christianity as the largest religious group in the world. While many may associate Islam with the geographical region of the Middle East, only 18% of Muslims are Arabs. Muslims represent the majority population in 56 countries. The Muslim population is a diverse community of believers spanning the globe. Many Muslims reside in Europe, Southeast Asia, and in the West. Islam is not limited to one ethnicity or a single group of people. Muslims are people from a wide variety of ethnic backgrounds, races, cultures, and national origins. Whereas more people proclaim themselves to be Christian, the religion that claims the most devoted and practicing followers is Islam. In other words, the world boasts a higher percentage of Muslims practicing Islam than Christians practicing Christianity. A Muslim is a person that submits his or her will to the Almighty God, as he acknowledges that God knows what's best for him. He follows God's commandments for his own best interests. A Muslim is someone who lives to attain purpose, and this purpose is found when one lives not only to better himself, but to better the things and people around him. A Muslim devotes himself to following God's commandments so he can live a peaceful and happy life in this world and so that he can prepare himself for the eternal joy in the next world. In Islam, the worship of God consists of every act, belief, statement, or sentiment of the heart which God approves and loves. Anything that brings a person closer to his Creator would be considered an act of worship. It includes physical and external forms of worship, like daily ritual prayers, fasting, and charity. It also involves internal worship, such as a keen faith in the angels, God's books, and his prophets. Acts of worship also include the loving of God, gratitude, and placing one's reliance on the Almighty. God is worthy and entitled to worship through the body, soul, heart, and mind. In Islam, a Muslim is not someone who simply knows the truth. A Muslim is someone that submits to the truth. A Muslim is someone that believes in God and follows God's commandments. Islam stresses belief, not simply believing in one's heart, but also acting on that belief. Mere faith counts for nothing if not carried into practice. The purpose of Islam is not knowledge, but submission. And no belief in itself can bring salvation. To simply acknowledge the existence of one God and to identify Muhammad as the last and final messenger does not make one Muslim. Even Satan harbors belief in his heart. Satan knows the truth and is a believer in God. Satan did not deny God as his Lord, as he had spoken to God. The Quran records a dialogue between Satan and his Lord. He said, "My Lord, then reprieve me until the day they are resurrected." Allah said, "Indeed, you are those reprieved until the day of time well known." Satan said, "Because you have put me in error, I will surely make disobedience attractive to them on earth, and I will mislead them all except among them your chosen servants." Yet Satan disobeyed his Lord and refused, stubbornly and arrogantly, to prostrate when his Lord commanded him to, which betrayed a nature of arrogance, self-admiration, and pride. The fact that Satan simply believed in the existence of God did not benefit him, as he showed no rightful act to back up his belief. Satan claimed his place amongst the disbelievers because his belief was cancelled out by his pride, arrogance, and stubbornness, not to mention his poor behavior before his Lord. Belief in God and the demonstration of that belief are complementary and intertwined. Love manifests itself in action, and the possession of a true and heartfelt belief results in good actions. If a man truly loves God, he would show it in his obedience to God's commandments, thus earning God's pleasure in the process. In addition, the performance of good deeds draws one closer to God. Islam states that it is only that priceless combination of inner belief and outward action that makes up what is known in Islam as Iman, which translates to faith. When a Muslim is obeying God's commandments, he is not denying himself the pleasure of this world. God makes humans the successors of this earth. God states in the Quran, and mention, O Muhammad, when your Lord said to the angels, indeed, I will make them upon earth a successive authority. Islam states that humans have been put on earth by God, and they are to use their material means to build a positive life in this temporary world, which will eventually lead them to a positive and eternal life in the hereafter. God states, but seek through that which Allah has given you, the home of the hereafter, and yet do not forget your share of the world, and do good as Allah has done good to you, and desire not corruption in the land. Indeed, Allah does not like corruptors. Islam certainly does not rob humans of the ability and the right to live well in this world. Rather, Islam teaches that every experience one has in this world should be valid and significant, not just a fleeting moment. Muslims do not live just to see the next new movie or game, or to buy the next high-tech phone. In the eyes of a Muslim, this world is a much deeper place. A Muslim lives for a more superior and powerful reason. A Muslim lives to find a purpose in his life, and that purpose is to discover who created him, to determine how his creator wants him to live, and to build a relationship with him. The opposite of a Muslim is a kafir. The Quran warns followers away from becoming kafirs. The word kafir occurs more than 150 times in the Quran. The word kafir refers to something that is covered. For instance, a farmer is also called a kafir in the Arabic language. This owing to the fact that a farmer covers seeds in the earth. The Quran uses the word kafir to describe a disbeliever, one that is insincere in their life, deliberately rejecting the truth that they covered despite knowing it was true. A kafir is also someone that refuses to question what they were taught as children. They blindly follow their forefathers without thinking, reflecting, and pondering over the uncertainty of their beliefs. They do not search for the truth. The word kafir in the West is usually translated to infidel, which is not the proper definition. The word infidel means someone who does not believe in God, whereas a kafir is someone that denies, conceals, or refuses the truth. A kafir is someone that rejects the truth, or that knows the truth but refuses to act upon it. A disbeliever is also someone that is ungrateful, that chooses to live, hide, or cover themselves in the darkness of ignorance. Islam does not teach followers to hate non-Muslims. In fact, Islam came to bring dignity to all human beings. The Quran explicitly states that all children of Adam are honored. God has given respect to all sons of Adam, which would include every human being. If God gives respect to them, then we certainly need to respect them as well. God states, and we have certainly honored the children of Adam, and carried them on land and sea, and provided for them of the good things, and preferred them over much of what we have created, with definite purpose. The term children of Adam, which God uses to refer to mankind, excludes any discrimination on race, color, gender. Human dignity is universal, since all human beings are descendants of Adam. God also commanded his angels to prostrate to them in humility before Adam, the father of mankind, as he was created to elevate the status and honor of humanity. In addition, God mentions in the Quran about how he honored the sons of Adam and made them noble, created them in the best fashion and most perfect forms. We have certainly created man in the best stature. God is very explicit in the Quran about the treatment of non-Muslims. He insists that even if one's parents are idol worshippers who force them to worship false gods, they should not worship those gods, yet still treat their parents with the utmost respect and love. During the time of the Prophet, Prophet Muhammad was portrayed sitting with his companions when a funeral service passed in front of them. Prophet Muhammad stood. Then one of his companions asked, "Why are you standing? This is a funeral service of a Jew." Prophet Muhammad replied, "Was it not a soul?" He was teaching his companions that all humans are valuable. Islam teaches that the only real criterion that sets one human being above others is that of piety, God consciousness, in actions and righteousness. O mankind, indeed we have created you from male and female, and made you peoples and tribes, that you may know one another. Indeed, the most noble of you in the sight of Allah is the most righteous of you. Indeed, Allah is knowing and acquainted. A Muslim is someone that doesn't make wealth, health, and power the ultimate aims of his life. Whereas Muslims use these for a means of living, it's not their aim or goal. A Muslim has much bigger aim in life than gathering of temporary material goods. Since the life of the Prophet is full of countless examples that show his status as a role model for mankind, for societies and individuals, one can find truths in Prophet Muhammad's life that constitute an example for them to follow. His life was full of good manners, superior morality, generosity, good habits, politeness, respect, gentleness, noble feelings, and wisdom from God, all of which help mankind live a better, peaceful, easier life full of good. Emulating the Prophet would also help one from falling into error or sin. Prophet Muhammad was the sacred model for mankind to emulate and follow his footsteps, as was sent by God as an example how one should live his life to the best of his ability. Thus, Muslims study the biography of the Prophet Muhammad, which they call Sirah. Muslims believe the easiest road to goodness, to moral excellence and success in this life and the afterlife comes through the emulation of the Prophet. Muslims emulate Prophet Muhammad's faith, behavior, attitude, manners, patience, compassion, piety, and even daily tasks like the way he ate, drank, slept, interacted with others, etc. The teachings of Prophet Muhammad acts as a mercy and a healing for all mankind. In Islam, every good deed is an act of charity, called sadaqah in Arabic. Whether it's doing justice between people, helping others, giving a good word, being kind to others, or removing harmful objects from the road, all have a special reward that would be given from God if one has a pure intention and is doing it for the sake of God. A Muslim is someone that consistently tries to improve himself or herself and tries to perfect his manners. Islam stresses the importance of good manners. Implementing good manners in Islam is reinforcing one's faith. Not only do good manners gain love and respect of the Creator and the people around, good manners are the foundation of a Muslim's daily life, through which he or she achieves success in this world as well as the hereafter. Prophet Muhammad said, "I have been sent to perfect good manners." This includes the teachings on how one conducts themselves with their Lord, their selves, and the people around them. God states, "And do good as Allah has done good to you, and desire not corruption in the land. Indeed, Allah does not like corruptors." A Muslim is someone that treats his parents, spouse, children, and family kindly. Islam forbids Muslims from mistreating and being unjust to their parents or family, and made it compulsory for one to treat them with all goodness and mercy. Children must take great caution not to disrespect or react negatively to their parents. If the parents do or say which is not liked or approved by the child must show patience and tolerance instead of giving vent to their anger. Disobeying one's parents is regarded as one of the grave sins. Islam states, one should be more loving, respectful, grateful, kind, and compassionate to their mothers since they went through pain and suffering and loved their child before they were even born. A mother toiled her child when one was a helpless infant, while she spent sleepless nights caring and worrying. God states, "And your Lord has decreed that you not worship except Him, and to your parents good treatment, whether one or both of them reach old age. Say not to them, Uff, and do not repel them, but speak to them a good noble word." Islam also teaches one to respect his or her spouse as well as being good to women. Prophet Muhammad states, "The best of you are those who are best to their wives." And God also commanded men to treat their wives with kindness and live with them in kindness. For if you dislike them, it may well be that you dislike something which God might yet make a source of abundant good. Islam places great emphasis on both physical and spiritual cleanliness, health, hygiene, and purification. Muslims are required to take care of their personal hygiene by assuring that they are well-groomed with their body and clothing, and that their environment is clean and pure. God's Prophet and Messenger Muhammad stated, "Cleanliness is half of faith." Prophet Muhammad also stated, "The religion of Islam is clean, hence one should also keep themselves clean. No one will be allowed to enter paradise except he who is clean." This cleanliness is both of the body and the mind. Additionally, God states in the Quran, Allah has ordained for you, indeed, Allah loves those who are constantly repentant and loves those who purify themselves. In fact, prior to the prayers that Muslims are required to perform, one is required to assure that he is in state of cleanliness, which he does by performing either wudu, which is often translated as ablution, which is the washing with water to remove minor impurities, such as impurities or dirt from the teeth, ears, nostrils, etc., or ghusl, a full bath for major impurities after sexual intercourse or after the completion of a woman's menstrual period. Islam teaches Muslims the best way to greet his fellow brother or sister is with the Islamic greeting of Assalamu alaikum, which translates, peace be upon you, which grants the other for protection, safety, security, and mercy from evils and faults. The name As-Salam is one of the names of God in Arabic, so it also means, may the blessing of his name descend upon you. No matter what nationality, ethnicity, or color a Muslim brother or sister may be, it is an obligation for one to greet his fellow brother or sister as family, since all Muslims share the belief in one God and the last and final Prophet Muhammad. Prophet Muhammad stated, the Muslim has five rights over his fellow Muslim. He should greet him with As-Salam, visit him when he is sick, attend his funeral, accept his invitation, and ask God to have mercy upon him when he sneezes. Thus, it has been made obligatory for the one being greeted to greet in return with As-Salamu Alaikum. Our Prophet narrated, whoever guides another to a good deed will get a reward similar to the one who performs it. So please like, subscribe, and share this video. Assalamu alaikum.